listening to Conferences Online Allergy from Children's Mercy Hospitals and Clinics in Kansas City, Missouri. Today is September 19, 2016, and I'm your host, Dr. Jay Portnoy. Our topic today, eosinophilic esophagitis. Our presenter is Dr. Stephanie Page. She's a gastroenterologist in the Division of Pediatric Gastroenterology at Children's Mercy Hospital in Kansas City, Missouri.
Dr. Stephanie Page. Dr. Page is a gastroenterologist here at Children's Mercy Hospital. I've had the pleasure of working with Stephanie for it's like 6 or 7 years now. We lost track. We've been doing a combined eosinophilic esophagitis clinic here at Children's Mercy, and actually we have one this afternoon. And Stephanie's here this morning to talk about eosinophilic esophagitis, and so I'll let her begin.
So good morning. Still morning, 11:10, so it's not quite afternoon yet. So as Paul said, he and I run our EOE multidisciplinary clinic, and then Ashley Regsager, who is my nurse practitioner, she and I tend to do most of the follow-ups with EOE and send Paul a lot of questions when it comes to allergy components of this. And so I am very pleased to be here today. I love talking about EOE, and it's a lot of fun and can be stressful at the same time. So these are the five objectives as I see them, and I think if you can understand this by the end of the lecture, then you'll have a decent idea of what EOE is. So there's a true definition for eosinophilic esophagitis. There is a presumed pathogenesis understanding. Then there's workup and evaluation and what's involved in this, as well as what is the treatment and why do we treat. And that why do we treat is really the impetus for why we form the clinic. So what exactly is eosinophilic esophagitis? Is it new? Is it old? Is it food-related? Is it environmental-related? Is it just bad reflux? Really, what is EOE? And, you know, the Sentinel paper was written in 1996, and then the first set of guidelines were written in 2007. So 11 years to truly understand what EOE really is. And so you also have to say, in order to say what EOE is, you have to say what it is not, or, you know, what other causes of eosinophilia can be in the esophagus. So things such as reflux, PPI-responsive esophageal eosinophilia, there can be infectious esophagitis, eosinophilic gastroenteritis, flesh and gastrointestinal disease, you can have hyper-eosinophilic syndromes, you can have parasitic infections, you can see eosinophils in the esophagus with inflammatory bowel disease, you can see with drug-induced and drug-associated esophagitis, and particularly like doxycycline with pill esophagitis, you can see eosinophils there with that. You can see, you know, some random eosinophilia with achalasia, and then also with connective tissue disorders. And so all eosinophils in the esophagus does not equal EOE, if that makes sense. So the 2007 definition really looked at clinical symptoms of esophageal dysfunction. You had to have more than 15 eosinophils in one or more biopsy. You couldn't have reflux. Okay, that makes sense. And then in 2011, so 4 years later, there was actually a lot of information developed in that timeline, and so they felt that the guidelines really needed to be reevaluated at that time. EOE used to be EE, but that was very, very confusing because adult gastroenterologists call EE erosive esophagitis. And so there was a complete disconnect in communication and conversation between allergy and adult GI and then subsequently peds GI when people said EE, well, are you talking about erosive esophagitis, which is a very different entity than EOE. So that's when really the diagnosis of EOE, the abbreviation, became known. Also, they included the term chronic, knowing that it had, there had to be some chronic changes, so this is a chronic disease process. We found out in that four-year time period that it was more of an antigen, immune/antigen-driven disease. It needed to have clinical symptoms as well as pathology, and there was no change, though, in the threshold of 15 eosinophils per high-power field. There was also no change in the units, and that's primarily because you had to have some sort of unit standardized across all, really across the world and across all pathologists. The problem with this is there's no set size for a high power field. Pathologists have different high power field sizes and views, and so there's been some discussion as to do you do mean eos for hyperphil, do you do peak eosinophils for hyperphil, because the values can be different, and ultimately the decision was made to use peak eosinophils for hyperphil. The 2011 guideline said, yes, we can do topical steroids, yes, we should do that exclusion, one of the two. It provided more detail regarding PPI response of esophageal eosinophilia and the need for ruling out reflux. And then it also included a group where if it looks like axillic and sounds like EOE, but by golly, they only had 10 eosinophils, so that's not EOE. Yeah, no, they took that out and said, really use your clinical judgment. You know, if it acts like, walks like, and quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. It just may not have the same features. It might be an albino duck, you know. So EOEs being somewhat similar in the fact that you have to use clinical judgment. If there's 10 eosinophils, but they have dysphagia, they have food impactions, then you have to include them, or at least potentially treat them, with the family understanding the caveat of the diagnosis isn't 100% certain, but we think this is what's going on. And then it also talked more about this whole PPI response of esophageal eosinophilia, which tends to confuse nearly everybody. So what are the symptoms of EOE? Really, in children, they're vastly different than adults. Adults have a pretty standard presentation, usually food impactions, usually trouble swallowing, can be chest pain, can be abdominal pain, but 90%+ of the time, it's really difficulty swallowing, some sort of esophageal dysfunction. In children, though, in the young infants, it's feeding refusal, feeding intolerance, in clinic, they end up scoping most of the children who don't eat because half of them end up with EOE. So one of our direct referrals really is the feeding clinic here at Children's Mercy. Heartburn and regurgitation, or prolonged regurgitation, prolonged heartburn, they've been on meds, high-dose PPIs for 2 or 3 years, and they're still symptomatic. We'll scope them. Sometimes they have EOE. There's definite overlap between them. Oftentimes vomiting and abdominal pain. And then as you get older, closer to the teenage years, dysphagia and food impaction tend to be the primary symptoms, mimicking more of an adult presentation. So epidemiology, who does this happen to? So really it's a worldwide phenomenon. It's males more than females. Definitely familial clustering. In fact, I would dare say Paul and I have diagnosed many, many, probably 15 parents with EOE. When they're like, this sounds like me, when we go through all the history of what EOE is and what the symptoms are, and parents are like, but I've had this for 10 years. And we're like, yeah, and you need to see a gastroenterologist. So we've diagnosed many, many, many families. We've diagnosed siblings. We have several families that have 3 or 4 affected children. It's pretty predominant within families. The prevalence data varies quite a bit. You can see in Switzerland, it's 1 in 4,000, which is a pretty large number. Australia had 1 in 70,000. Cincinnati had numbers of 0.1%. When you take data back to 2000, 2003, the incidence was 4 to 5 per 10,000. Sorry, incidence was 1 in 10,000, but prevalence was 4 to 5 per 10,000. Just this summer was a recent study where they looked at billing codes for a huge region in the U.S. and found the prevalence to be about 27 per 100,000. So the prevalence is staying somewhat steady. And if you'll notice, the gray zone being the gray bars being female, male bars being male, this is seriously a male predominant disease. And you can see there's really peaks in teenagers and then peaks again in the late 30s. We don't understand why it drops off after the 60s, whether that's just the information wasn't collected at that time period, but it's believed to be a lifelong disease, so this should extend out even further. All right, so this just gave you some percentages about symptoms and about region, and all of those who have allergic disease coincidence with them. Okay. So why does EOE happen? What is the pathogenesis behind this? And that's actually where a lot of the focus of research has been for the last several years. It was definitely believed to be an immune-mediated response. It's associated with ATP and food antigen sensitivity. Mouse models have been able to reproduce EOE, and they know that EOE is cell-mediated. They know that it's not totally IgE-mediated. It doesn't create EOE, but it is believed that it can continue EOE, if that makes sense. So that study was pretty interesting because that's when we added in some really IgE testing into our clinic, which really hasn't been that helpful necessarily. So when you look at the alloarigen exposure, they have looked quite dramatically at how does EOE occur. And so when you get this pulmonary exposure to inhaled antigens, they have found that there's been intranasal exposure can elicit EOE in mice. Inhaled exposure creates some mast cell activation within the esophagus, which led to some eosinophilic disease in the esophagus. Also, they have found that when you swallow aeroallergens, it can provoke a hypersensitivity response. And so aeroallergens might be involved kind of in the creation of EOE, but aren't believed to be the primary problem within EOE. So then the thought was, well, maybe we get this because there's a skin problem. While we do know that eczema is very prominent in HOP, and we know that most children with EOE have some component of HOP, and a lot of them have eczema. And so there was some thought, perhaps, you know, the epicutaneous allergen sensitization primes the respiratory allergen-induced EOE. And so it's a little bit far-fetched, but probable, if that makes sense. So definitely having sensitivity to your skin, exposure to your skin stimulates more of a body response, which then predisposes to EOE. Okay. Where the money is, though. So there are cytokines that have been found to be very, very involved within the development of eosinophilic esophagitis, in particular IL-13, eotaxin 3, and IL-5. So they know that IL-13 is overexpressed in the esophagus of patients with EOE. We know that IL-13 induces eotaxin 3. So what is eotaxin 3? Well, it's a molecule that basically says, here, eosinophils, come here, come here, come here. It's the most highly induced gene within the EOE transcriptome that Cincinnati has really evaluated. And you can look at levels of eotaxin 3 mRNA in the esophagus, and you can predict who has GERD and who actually has EOE. So we know that eotaxin 3 is very involved in the development of EOE, and we know that IL-13 creates more eotaxin 3. And then IL-5 is also very involved in that it regulates kind of eosinophil numbers as well as the eosinophil response to eotaxin 3. And they have found that increased IL-5 can induce EOE in mice as well. Okay, so eosinophils, well, why them? I mean, they release major basic protein. They also, if you look at it, release IL-5, IL-13. So it's basically a full circle. They, when they release their chemicals, they're creating more eotaxin 3 and IL-13. They're creating more IL-5. They're basically self-generating themselves. They don't undergo cell death when they release their chemicals, and they directly present their antigen and they activate T cells, which is very important. TGF-beta-1 is overexpressed in EOE, and it has direct effects on esophageal fibroblasts as well as smooth muscle cells, as well as increasing gene expression for fibrosis, smooth muscle cell contraction, and mesenchymal transformation. And you can see that TGF-beta is released by eosinophils as well. There is one slide I was unable to get in before the deadline, and this is kind of the what's hot in EOE, unfortunately. It's called Calpain-14. And if you go to any of the EOE conferences, Calpain-14 is like the big thing they are talking about right now. And Cincinnati did a review, and they found the strongest genome-wide association with Calpain-14 on chromosome 2p23. It's a calcium-activated protease, and it restructures cytoskeletal and membrane proteins. Calpain-14 is one of the most highly expressed proteases in the esophagus. It's located in a hot spot that's modified by IL-13. The increase in IL-13 can increase the Calpain-14. It gets upregulated by both IL-4 and IL-13. So again, you see just the beauty of the need for IL-13 and how it's just this continuous circle. What they have found is that overexpression of Calpain-14 in esophageal epithelial cells was sufficient to induce disruption of the epithelial cell architecture within the esophagus and impaired barrier function. Also, overexpression of calpain 14 reduces the desmoglein 1 expression, which impairs barrier cell function as well and contributes to the development of eosinophilic esophagitis. So I actually think calpain 14 is probably a pretty big mediator within EOE development. And that data will continue to come over the next year. All right, so what about the genetics? So in April 2010, there was huge news that they had found it. They thought they found a big gene, and they sort of found the big gene. So 5q22.1, there's a particular SNRP, which was one of my favorite terms in medical this particular SNP spans the TSLP-WDR36 gene region, and it was found both in 181 EOE patients through Rothenberg's group, and then Leah Kirst's group also had quite a few that they submitted controls as well as EOE cases. And so this TSLP, let's see, where did I talk about it? Here we go. So the TSLP was significantly overexpressed in EOE cases compared to controls, and this WDR36 was unaltered. They actually believed that the TSLP component is pretty important within the genetics, and you'll see that TSLP production increases eotaxin 1 and eotaxin 2. It enhances disease severity. It increases your skin sensitization, and they believe it's a key mediator in allergy, in the development really of allergy and inflammatory disease, and initiating allergen sensitization. That actually makes a lot of sense. So it would make sense that a lot of these kids who have EOE have worsening of their TSLP, which increases their allergy sensitization. And so the pathogenesis is still being delineated. Nobody can tell you it's one particular thing. It looks like there's multiple different factors. IL-5, IL-13, eotaxin 3, TSLP, all of these things are intricately needed. So, okay, we know that more things will be coming down the pike. So what's the work of an evaluation of EOE? Well, this is a normal appearing esophagus. Okay, so this is what I see every day when I scope, or at least this is what I'm looking for when I scope. Is this normal or not? And you have to have an HED for diagnosis. You have to. I've actually had come across two patients now who I believe had EOE in both families, despite hours of counseling, have refused an HED and plan to just proceed with diet elimination, even though it's not a confirmed diagnosis. So the things that we're looking for, we're looking for basically furrowing, which I call railroad tracks. You can see lines down the esophagus. We're looking for friability. We're looking for edema, which presents as you can see the blood vessels very clearly, right? Well, when there's edema and there's fluid, you can't. It can be very pale. Sometimes when you're taking biopsies, you can actually take off this very long part, and the GI doc's heart rate goes up quite a bit, this whole longitudinal shearing, as you're just pulling parts of the esophagus off, and you start to panic a little bit, but generally that's fine. You see a lot of white flecks or white specks, which is really interesting. When one of the attendings was new, she came to me and she's like, "Stephanie, I think your EOE patient has fungus, has yeast." She's like, "There was white everywhere," and I said, "I bet you $10 that comes back with eosinophilic microabscesses." And all it is just collections of eosinophils within the esophagus, these white cells. You can see transient or fixed rings, but ding, 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 30% of people with EOE can have a normal appearing esophagus. So it's not always what it seems to be. So this here, if you can see the white lines, or see the white arrows, this here is what we call furrowing. These are what I call the railroad tracks, just going down. And you can see how, compared to the normal esophagus, if you have an esophagus that looks like this, it's not going to feel good to swallow. It's going to feel really weird. And that's one of the things we talk about in clinic. It's not a nice, easy swallow. It's a discoordinated swallow that makes swallowing very painful sometimes. And then this is not something we commonly see in kids. This is something they see more in adults, the trachealization of the esophagus. And so some people are like, "Oh my God, I'm in the wrong hole." And then you freak out a little bit because you're like, I've never once intubated the trachea and I don't ever want to. And then you pull back and you're like, but this is the esophageal entrance. And you're like, oh, okay. They actually have trachealization of the esophagus, and so they probably have eosinophilic esophagus.
This is also called Schatzky's rings.
So other more subtle things. So a Schatzky's ring, just to address that, you can see kind of a lift in the distal part of the esophagus, and I use the word outcrouching a little bit. Okay, so other things that I look at, when any of my partners are like, oh my gosh, they have a ton of eosinophils, I'm not always worried about the eosinophil count. I worry about how much inflammation is there. So is there evidence of active degranulation? Okay, is there evidence of microabscesses? Is there layering of the eosinophils? I don't care so much about the basal zone hyperplasia, though that can be more symptomatic or more problematic with EoE. I care about fibrosis, and presence of mast cells have been shown to be increased in patients with EoE. We don't automatically stain for mast cells, just kind of as a heads up. That's more for research purposes. But also when Dr. Dowling and I recommend a diet elimination, and so I have a kid with huge numbers of EoE, tons of degranulation, tons of fibrosis, I'm also looking at their follow-up scopes of, did that degranulation go away? Did the clustering go away? Did the fibrosis go away? And am I just looking at numbers? How much of the esophagus appears healed?
What do you mean by the degranulation sign?
You can actually see, if you look under the microscope, you can see at different layers the different granules and such within the staining. And so pathology differs on do they count only intact eosinophils or do they count also degranulated eosinophils. Our pathologists here tend to count mostly intact eosinophils, but will comment on degranulated and open eosinophils. And so just kind of as a side note, if you guys ever see referrals from Dr. Friesen, who comments on duodenal eosinophilia, he changes the numbers from the pathologist because he includes the counts for the degranulated eosinophils. The pathologists do not. So he goes in because he feels that the degranulated eosinophils matter just as much as the intact eosinophils. So he often we'll do kind of a sub note saying, I actually count 50 eosinophils, mostly degranulated, that sort of thing. So that's why we look at the degree of inflammation within the esophagus. So this is a regular view of what you would see if you just put the slide right under the microscope. And and you can see that there's a lot more purple here than you should be seeing. And so when you look at high power view, at a high power field, there's more than 40 here. I mean, pathologists have gotten so good, they just eyeball. And so generally, when I've talked to them, if they say more than 40, there's usually between 40 and 45 or 40 and 50. If they say more than 20, it's usually 20 to 25. They won't say more than 20 and have it be 100, mm-hmm. That sort of thing. So it's generally within 5 to 10 of an eyeball count, if that makes sense. Okay. So biopsy numbers. So, this was a question years ago of how many biopsies do you need? Because each pathology tin that we put the specimens in is $250. Okay, so each one you submit to the pathologist has, a charge with it. So how many biopsies do you need? How many do you want in each cup that you give them? Well, one specimen provides a sensitivity of only 55%. But if you get 5 specimens with 5 biopsies, you can improve your sensitivity to 100%. So our guidelines are if it's a known EoE patient or suspected EoE patient, they are to get 4 in the distal esophagus and 4 in the middle esophagus. EoE is a very patchy disease. They have done autopsies on people with eosinophilic esophagitis and seen the counts differ even just by micrometers within the esophagus. And so the more biopsies that you have from more scattered locations, the higher your yield. And also, if you think a child has EoE and you have 6 biopsies or 7 or 8 and the counts are 0, you can say with a lot more confidence, you don't have EoE. We need to look for something else that could be causing your dysphagia, your trouble swallowing, or your abdominal pain. But the more biopsies you have, the stronger you can feel this is EoE or not.
Is this universally accepted? the biopsy numbers. Because the reason, again, I ask is because the same patient, they ended up doing one biopsy at the distal esophagus.
No, the adults don't take lots of biopsies. So there's been a lot of education at these at Tigers meetings of really saying you've got to increase your biopsy yield. And there's been a lot of education for the families to be self-advocates and say, please take three or four. Please take three or four from the distal, three or four from the middle. And that's also why when I get referrals in from outside, I'm looking at how many did they take. And sometimes we're in the same boat. They only had one. And you're like, I'm sorry, that's not helpful.
What would you consider the minimum acceptable?
Six.
So three distal, three.
That's, yes.
And if, okay. All right.
That is my minimal acceptability. And I get really agitated and start sending out emails when I start to see a pattern of people not taking enough biopsies. Because if we're going to put a kid under anesthesia and sedate them, I want the information I need. So.
Also minimum for like a new diagnosis or possible new diagnosis?
Not always. So when you have a child with abdominal pain or are vomiting, the standard really is two in the distal esophagus. I mean, that's just, you want to get esophageal biopsies. You're not 100% convinced it's EOE, and so you don't tell them, I'm worried about EOE. This is just an abdominal pain complaint. Go in, make sure they don't have duodenitis, make sure they don't have anything else.
Yeah.
And so you get two. So say the numbers come back high, you know, 50. You're like, oh, crap, I wish I'd gotten mid. Oh, well. Then you put them on high-dose acid therapy, and you rescope, and when you rescope, you get the mid.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
However, if the gastroenterologist is astute and goes in for an abdominal pain and they see linear furrows, I've asked them all to please use their clinical judgment and pay 4 and 4. And I've trained all my techs, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And if they're an EOE or presumed EOE or look like EOE, get more biopsies. And so that's what we do here. Other adult gastroenterologists, they don't biopsy. EOE was truly found to be a pediatric disease first because adults don't biopsy if it doesn't look abnormal. And they also don't get enough when it does look at them.
Can I ask a question before going, since you're doing diagnostic testing? We were doing board review questions on Friday, and one of the questions that had been proposed by the radiologists when they were here talking about radiology for the allergist is that they had a case presentation of someone who they thought had EOE, and one of the recommendations they had as a study was esophagram. So I'm just curious when you think it's necessary to do an esophagram.
It's a great question. I didn't address that in the talk, so that's a really great question. So if a kiddo has trouble swallowing and they can't really swallow solids very well, but they can swallow liquids and I'm worried about a stricture, I will always get an esophagram first. Always. If they have it, because we've done that before, we've been like, oh, difficulty swallowing, let's get in there, and you get in there and you're like, oh crap, I can't advance the esophagus at all. And so then you either have to leave the room, consent the family for a dilation, and come back and dilate, and then get biopsies. But if I have any concerns at all that there could be a stricture, then I get one ahead of time. But I don't routinely get esophagrams in kids.
So probably more like in the teenagers who have the difficulty swallowing, mm-hmm. the main complaint.
Mm-hmm. And so we just put in referrals for an esophagram. Sometimes people do an upper GI just to be thorough, but an esophagram is sufficient.
The thing is that a lot of the teenagers that we see in the clinic have presented to the emergency room because of food being caught or stuck, and then the gastroenterologist have to go down and pull it out, and then that's when they find the stuff is not, mm-hmm. they do it beforehand.
So that has happened. Yeah, and sometimes in the ER they will ask for an esophagram so they can fully identify where the food bolus is ahead of time. You know, is it really distal? Is it proximal? Because the more proximal it is, the more they're at risk for having problems. Yeah. And then the pH study is also helpful. So we, a lot of times, get patients who have been on 1.2 milligrams per kilogram of PPI, and there is really no set standard. The standard is high dose. PPI, and so in papers and in the literature, it looks like the goal is really about 2 milligrams per kilogram, and that's what all the lectures are talking about, is about 2. But at the same time, PPIs come in 10s, 20s, 30s, and 40s, and so does it have to be twice a day? No. It can be once a day. So if you have a 15-kilo kid, you can put them on Prevacid 30 milligrams once a day, and you've sufficiently hit your 2 milligram per kilogram dose. And that's the thing that I stress to my own partners is I'm like, it doesn't have to be 20 BID. 20 BID involves a prior authorization through insurance and all that 2 month delay because you can't get the BID component approved. I don't care if they're on 41 today and they're 5 years old. Like, I don't care. I just want them on 2 per kilo. And so I've also started putting in the e-prescription note to pharmacy, ruling out eosinophilic esophagitis, because oftentimes they'll get a call back saying, that dose is too high for kids. And you're like, yeah, I know, but I'm not, it's not like I'm going to keep them on this for forever. This is an 8-week trial and then a follow-up scope, and then we're going to get them off. Really is the plan. So anyway, when they come to our clinic, if they're not on high enough dosing, we often will order a pH probe study just to definitively take out the reflux component. Now, that has both pros and cons. Because if you happen to do the pH study on a day where it's a normal day for them, you can feel confident if the pH probe study is negative, that it's truly negative. But if they're a person who's been very, very symptomatic, they have regurgitation, they have reflux, you do a pH probe study, and it's a day that is typically, that is abnormal for them, they have no symptoms, and it's negative, that doesn't mean anything. You just didn't grab it on a day that that's normal for them. So there's pros and cons to doing a pH probe study, really. But at the same time, if you're just doing it for EOE and they have abdominal pain and they really have no other symptoms and you just want a quick answer, then getting a negative pH probe study is reassuring as well. So let's talk about proton pump inhibitors. So we feel very strongly that it needs to be trialed first. We will take referrals for EOE into our clinic, but if we feel they haven't been trialed on a high dose, or a high enough dose, we will fix that problem and fully declare themselves as to whether or not they are EOE or not. Paul and I very strongly believe that no person should get a lifelong diagnosis without true, correct diagnostic criteria. Because right now we have no end in sight, you know, so we don't want to give a 2-year-old a diagnosis of EOE if they just happen to have really bad pain. So what have they found? Well, proton pump inhibitors actually have been found to help heal the mucosa of the esophagus within petri dishes and in research labs. And so this provides a little bit of a compounding factor in diagnostic purposes, because you put a kid on 40, you know, place in a teenager on 40 BID and they come back and they're like, oh my God, I feel so much better. I feel wonderful. All my symptoms are gone. But, you know, we really should still rescope just to make sure the eosinophils are gone. And they still have 80. You know, in the esophagus, they're like, how the heck do you still feel so much better? And you can see they have found in research protocols that PPIs can be anti-inflammatory, they can be antioxidants, and some of this probably helps with the way their esophagus is healing, but the eosinophils are still there because they're still eating all their foods and they're still eating all their triggers. All right, so who should be involved? Well, all these people. Do we have a speech-language pathologist or an occupational therapist in our clinic? No, we actually don't, but we do refer very quickly to the feeding clinic if we feel that there are oral skills. We refer to the occupational therapy group if we feel they need more work with their eating. We have a nutritionist. We have a psychologist if needed. I've only encountered 2 or 3 kids, really, who have had some psychological issues with elimination diets and whatnot. I've only had 1 kid who had PTSD from their pH probe placement. So far we're doing pretty good. And then social work is actively involved, particularly with formulas and whatnot. So there must be an allergy evaluation, of course. This is an allergic disease, so an allergist should be involved. And in most centers, actually, allergy is kind of the primary treater of EOE. Here, though, I tend to be a little bossy. I like that. So 50-80% will have a history of atopia. I really need to change this 100%. I took this from a study where they found, really, when looking at kids, peripheral eosinophilia counts do matter for some kids, but you can see that 20% of kids don't have elevated peripheral eosinophilia counts. And so sometimes we do see kids with quite elevated, but it's not 100%.
No, I think
it is most certainly not 100%. I would say probably 50 to 60%. And then a lot of children had elevated IgE levels, but I think that's just again, most of these kids have allergy disease. So you can do skin prick testing, but this just evaluates the IgE response, which is not the primary mediator of EOE. And we do patch testing here. So Spergel and Leocurse, this is one of their initial studies. I include it because it's kind of the primary initial looking at allergy evaluation. And so they looked at skin prick, they looked at patch testing, they looked at combinations of these. And the unifying factor is that most of the foods typically are milk, soy, wheat, chicken, rice, beef, corn. So that will help you see why we choose the foods that we do that eliminate, that we recommend for elimination. Actually, a lot of centers now aren't doing any allergy testing. So in particular, when they looked at who responded to diet restrictions, so they had a 77% response, or at least resolution of patients with EOE, and their counts went from 48 to 1.1. And then when you reintroduced foods, they recurred. 15 did not respond to diet elimination, which I find very interesting because when you look at the elemental amino acid-based data, only 97% of kids respond to that, which means 3% of kids can't be fixed with diet, and make me wonder if they're not primarily diet, if they're primarily aeroallergen or something else.
Do you know how long, like how long is that for the elimination period?
This was 6 weeks. They looked at positive predictive values and negative predictive values for skin prick and HPV patch testing, but these are listed for, this was from a study done in 2006 and published in 2007. And ultimately, though, in the last 9 years, there's been more data to indicate really that prick skin testing hasn't been as helpful. Patch testing really has been as helpful, and there really aren't any allergy tests that are predictive or beneficial, which is relatively disappointing in the field of EOE. Okay, so the treatment of EOE. These are really the things that we offer families. The solid steroids, directed food elimination diet, cow milk only restricted diet, pork food elimination, six food elimination diet, elemental diet. We don't really offer monolith tests, and we don't offer biologic agents here, but those have been found and used in research purposes. So the solid steroids that are used are primarily swallowed fluticasone and swallowed budesonide. Cyclosanide is used as a last resort, usually, and my N of 2 haven't really worked. So in 2006, Connor Koff put his initial trial in for fluticasone and showed improvements in eosinophil. Then they did a study looking at fluticasone versus prednisone, and well, you can imagine what the results were. They were pretty good. The prednisone worked better than the fluticasone, which isn't too terribly surprising in my opinion, but at the same time, the prednisone group had more side effects. All this indicates to me is that fluticasone is a pretty good treatment, and it's 220, twice, two puffs swallowed twice a day, and so that's the typical 880 that they were studying. Candida was one of the primary side effects that they saw, and this being my favorite. So I actually do more with viscous budesonide than I do with solvent. Viscous budesonide is basically the pulmicort vial. You add it to some sort of medium, and you swallow it twice a day. People differ on the doses. My goal is I start low, and I increase to a higher dose if needed. Small kids get 0.25 up to like 3 or 4 years of age. Medium kids, you get 0.5, swallow twice daily. And if you're a teenager who's very tall, then you get probably 1 milligram twice a day. When I look at kids, I look at how big they are. I look at how tall they are because I look kind of at their esophagus length and how long it is, so how much medicine might they need. In the initial studies, the kids who are less than 10 received lansoprazole 15 BID, and for the kids who were older than 10, they were on 30 BID, and each vial was mixed with Splenda. And so they had 31 randomized patients, 24 completed, 15 did oral viscous budesonide, and 9 did placebo. So what they found is that the responders had less than 6, partial responders were 7 to 15, and non-responders were greater than 20. But if you follow this line, so oral viscous budesonide plus PPI, they all improved except for these two. These were partial responders. And then if they were on placebo and PPI, some got worse, some got better, which could be the PPI response of the esophageal eosinophilia group, truly. But if you look at month 1, month 2, month 3, the longer you were on it, the better you did. They looked at safety issues, mainly looking at cortisol levels and any other side effects, and there was no significant difference with the use of quercetin in their cortisol levels. There has recently been a study published where they did ACTH stim tests on all the kids who are getting sulbactam-9 and found that approximately half of them did show some signs of adrenal insufficiency that resolved when you eliminated this. I have been in discussion with our endocrine group for the last year to try and figure out a way to potentially monitor for adrenal insufficiency in these kids, and they don't really feel that there is a way, if they're on consistent steroids, how to measure that. Typically what I do is, if they've been on steroids longer than a year, I will check a serum cortisol level before they take a morning dose. The lower limits of cortisol in the morning is 7.5, and so if they're 8 or 9, I tell families, well, you may have another 6 months to a year. I'll recheck in 6 months. If their value is 13, 15, 20, whatever, then I say we're fine. I have had one kid who in particular had a cortisol of 7, and she had been on swallowed picazone for 9 years, and so we switched her from the swallowed steroids to diet. So we are actually seeing more of this, and I wouldn't be surprised if in the next 5 years we start to see more signs of adrenal insufficiency. Okay, so ciclesinide, we have no information on really effects or cortisol levels, because this isn't something that is commonly used. I've used it in 2 kids, like I said, and had no improvement. Denver uses it kind of as a last resort, and they've had some success with it. The case reports of ciclesinide have been primarily from Denver. So there have been a couple of studies looking at singular use in EOE. Some think it works. Some say it doesn't work. I have a study that shows that it sort of works. And the thought is that it doesn't change the eosinophil numbers, but it changes the eosinophil function, and by default, you probably get some symptom improvement. But it doesn't really improve EOE. They've looked at biologic agents, the anti-IL-5, and they really found that eosinophil counts got better, but symptoms didn't. Symptoms were no different than placebo, so why use a medication that's just going to improve your eosinophil counts but not your symptoms? They looked at the IL-4/13 one, like the dupilumab. Okay. So So that name is not familiar to me.
Okay.
What's it called again?
Dupilumab.
Dupilumab.
I will. IL-4.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. So directed food elimination diet. This comes from more from our patch testing, and so we're looking to eliminate the fewest number of foods possible to help these kids. And so we utilize patch testing here. Some places do primarily prick testing or IgE testing to determine what foods to eliminate. We've had some kids who were positive for pork, and so we eliminate pork and found that to be a highly allergenic food for them. For some, oats is positive, for some, potatoes positive. We don't see milk positive very often, but it usually has been correct when it's been positive. And so this is a diet that we offer families, and it's why we do the patch testing clinic. However, a lot of places aren't utilizing patch testing anymore, and our data we haven't reviewed our data yet, but our overall interpretation of our clinic is that patch testing is not very beneficial for teenagers. Most of our teenagers do not patch test positive to anything. Most of our younger children do. So once we analyze our data, we'll be looking at essentially altering who we offer patch testing to. There's a group in Chicago, Dr. Kegelwala. He did a retrospective review of their data and looked at particularly those kids who they had just recommended elimination of milk, and found that 7 had complete remission with counts of 0 to 1, and 4 had significant remission of 2 to 15. And you can see the counts went from 76 to 2 for most of them. So it's a pretty dramatic response on the elimination diet. Of the 6 who weren't considered in remission, all of them experienced decreased counts. They just weren't enough to fulfill remission criteria for them. And this group was also utilizing young children, so they found this to be effective in children who were between the ages of 2 and 12.
It seems to be more effective in boys than girls.
Yeah.
That maybe just go with the, as you said before, the frequency is more like teenagers.
Yeah. And I'm forwarding through some of these slides simply because I'm running behind in time. But the data is all there on your slide. So this looks to be effect of the 6-food elimination diet, Kegawala again. Really, you can see significant improvement here. This is before and after treatment with the diet, and this is before and after. So this is the 6-food elimination diet, and this is the elemental food diet. So they gave them the option of amino acid-based diet and 6-food elimination diet. And you can see that they actually parallel each other pretty well. Okay, so this was a study done in Spain and in adults. And so they recommended that all adults go on a 6-food elimination diet, and then they scoped them, and then they introduced wheat. And if at any point they recurred, they removed it from the diet and then went to the next step on reintroduction of food. And actually, that was a lot of scope for them. We do it a little bit differently, but they found that legumes were a pretty big component for them. And so legumes and nuts were huge, but cereals, the wheat-based products, which actually fits. A lot of the adult data coming out now indicates that the primary mediator of their EOE is wheat products. So wheat, cereals, legumes were huge. And milk was right up there at 62%. So.
Which is interesting because in our patient population, maybe you can correct me, but I don't remember really anybody or very few had really nuts being an issue. Or
yeah, no, I can only recall three off the top of my head who have had issues with nuts or legumes, really. So this is an adult study as well. Dr. Gonsalves is pretty prominent in EOE literature. And so you can see pre-diet, you can see post-diet, and you can see with food reintroduction, this is what them trying. These are four separate patients. So this first patient, second patient, and fourth patient, this was all wheat. So you can see it's improving in all of these. It's not normal by any means because they didn't give it long enough time to heal. But all these people had improvement in symptoms with the after removal of the food. And then when they reintroduced the foods, you can see that things even got more markedly worse, and they all became symptomatic. This one was milk, right here, so milk and wheat. All right, so if you look at an elemental diet, so an amino acid-based formula, 51 patients who did not respond to a proton pump inhibitor, this is one particular study, were started on NeoK Plus. They were allowed to take water, grapes, or apples, and they had a scope 4 weeks later, and all but two improved on the diet. And so their counts went from 33 plus or minus 10 to 1. It's a pretty remarkable improvement. And so when Dr. Dowling and I start kids on diet elimination, you know that amino acid-based formula, if they're going to work, generally will work between 4 and 6 weeks. That we could, in theory, rescope them, but we try not to scope them that quickly. So I'm just going to skip.
How long does that eosinophilia improvement correlate with their symptoms?
Pretty well. Yeah, pretty well. Dilation is something that adults use quite often. In fact, they will choose dilation over elimination diets and steroids. So when patients become symptomatic, they'll come in and get dilated. Then the guys will wait until they become symptomatic again, then they'll go in and dilate. There was some concern initially that it increased the risk for perforation, but they've subsequently found that. Although you have a higher chance of perforating, most don't. We do dilation in our kids too. However, we just saw a kid last month who had a stricture. We put him on a diet elimination, and the kid got rescoped last week, and the stricture's completely gone. So my partner came up to me. He was so excited. He's like, the stricture is gone. How did you do that? She had already had a dilation, yeah, and we put her on a diet elimination, and her stricture was gone in 6 weeks. Totally gone. Like, they had only been able to dilate up to 12 millimeters in her esophagus, which was totally normal inside. Yeah.
Wow, that's tiny.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Uh-huh. That's the kind of strictures we're talking about. So we don't utilize dilation as the primary option for
care courses.
Okay, so why do we treat EOE? Well, so there's been some data that indicate, is EoE in conjunction with celiac disease? Is celiac, are they the same? Is it a spectrum? Are they different? Does it really occur in coordination with the two? What's going on here? There are other diseases that can be associated with EoE, one of which is becoming celiac disease. We've actually had several come through the clinic who have celiac disease and have EoE. EoE is a Th2, celiac disease is a Th1. IL-15 may or may not be involved in this. Where's the overlap here? Are they two separate diseases? Something wrong with just the Th system? What exactly is causing this duplication? And some report that, no. In celiac disease, you just have esophageal eosinophilia. You don't actually have EoE. And the problem is the definition and the verbiage of all of this. So we do see this association of the two. Connective tissue disorders have become a pretty significant component of EoE. Kids with EoE have an eightfold risk of having connective tissue disease versus the general population. They think it's because TGF-beta, which is involved in the eosinophils, if you remember with all that, is has issues with connective tissue disorders because they have variants in the TGF-beta, and in particular Marfan syndrome, hypermobility, Ehlers-Danlos, and joint hypermobility syndrome can be diagnosed. We've actually found several kids with presumed connective tissue disorder. Usually it's benign joint hypermobility, and we have two with Ehlers-Danlos. So there's definite associations with other diseases. And so why, and we get this question all the time, why do we care about EoE? Besides the fact my child has symptoms of trouble swallowing, why should we care? Well, the lamina propria fibrosis that we worry about, the esophageal remodeling that we worry about, and the decreased compliance of the esophagus all leads to stricture. Now, I get asked this all the time. How long? How long before they stricture? We have absolutely no idea. We have no clue. Could be 5 years, could be 10 years. There are adults who present with EoE who have strictures. Like, I've had abdominal pain since I was 10 and just been told to suck it up and get used to it. So they truly have EoE when they were 10? Who knows? We have kids who present with strictures. So there's believed to be a subtype of EoE, one that's probably more fibrotic, fibrostenotic, and one that's not. There's actually a new paper out, I didn't have a chance to put this in here, where they specifically looked at subgroups within EoE, and they separated them into the dysphagia food impaction group and the abdominal pain group. The abdominal pain group actually mimics perfectly chronic abdominal pain. We see this in our clinic as well. And the dysphagia group looks more like a fibrostenotic disease profile. And so will the abdominal pain presenters of EoE go on to develop strictures? We don't know yet, but the fibrostenotic do. And so again, is it two subtypes? There's some interesting data. I didn't include it because I think it's too preliminary, that there's even three subgroups within the fibrostenotic group looking at different molecules that are more prevalent in them. And so there is certainly in the next few years, we're probably going to end up being subtyping these, and our therapies are going to be pointed towards what subtype they have. But stricture is the reason we care, in addition to a symptom. So the prognosis really is a chronic relapsing condition, something that's believed to be lifelong. Stricture formation is possible. You can consider dilation. And Alex Strawman is this brilliant Swiss man who was introduced one time at a conference of, and he is going to talk to you about a disease that doesn't really exist. Okay? And so you can imagine his career has actually been founded really in EoE and long-term data in adults. And he found that dysphagia persisted, particularly if there was fibrosis within the esophagus. But he found it, he followed adults for up to 11 and a half years and found that they continued to have symptoms. And so this is believed to be a lifelong disease where, just like other diseases, you can flare. You can go in remission, you can flare. Whether it's set off by viruses, whether it's set off by antibiotics, whether it's set off by food, nobody really knows. So this is how we propose following things. So if you have clinical suspicion of EoE, you get an ECG with biopsy. If there's eosinophils of greater than 15, you get put on a PPI trial of 2 milligrams per kilogram per day. You get an ECG with biopsy. If the counts are less than 15 and they've had resolution of symptoms, they can have GERD or they can have PPI response of esophageal eosinophilia. and we continue them on their PPI and we follow them. We've had five that we know that are PPI responsive EE. Of these, of the five, two have gone on to fully declare themselves as eosinophilic esophagitis. And I'll talk about that in a second. So then if they have more than 15 and their symptoms persist, they have EOE, and then you can do steroid therapy or diet therapy. Then you do an EGD to make sure that they've resolved. And then you can decide, was it inadequate response because they have another food trigger, or are they doing well?
So is that the outcome? I have a division meeting.
You're fine. I'm done.
Thank you.
I guess I won't talk about the other. Oh, the bell.
Yeah, time for one burning question. Anybody have a burning question?
Yeah. Is treatment of eosinophilic esophagitis lifelong? Or?
In my opinion, it is.
Okay.
Because, yeah, I don't know of anybody who's shown that their child's out for it and that the adult's out for it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank
is this
you.
Like a sometimes true question? Are you
I say false.
Nick, the middle one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what is
you?
Right?
No,
I put F.
I put
no,
F.
It's F.
You can have. You
I
have
thought
diarrhea.
You could have diarrhea. You
no.
One of your clients had diarrhea.
One of my clients. Oh, did it?
Yeah.
Because I.
I didn't know. It's a very large question diarrhea.
Oh, yes. You caught me. Because that's the infant group.
Oh, okay.
That I really want.